Good morning, Miss Janice.
Good morning. Welcome to Hilldale United Methodist Church. Glad to see you this morning.
Thank you. Happy Sunday. Beautiful people of Hilldale, it is such a glorious week. I hope you have enjoyed this beautiful spring weather, and we are so glad that you are here with us at worship this morning. My name is Stephen Sauls, and I'm the pastor here at Hilldale United Methodist Church, and it's my pleasure to welcome you in the name of Jesus Christ to worship this morning. If you are new with us, we love that you are here this morning. We would love for you to just comment new right now. Let us know you're here, and somebody will follow up with you. We would love to make a $5 donation in your name to a local charity here in town just because you came and visited and watched us online today. So take a moment to let us know you're here. So whether you're new or not, please comment below and let us know that you're here. We love to see all the people connecting and getting to know each other and catching up with each other right here in the midst of worship. That is an important part of what we do and part of this community that God has called us to. So comment down below, take a picture of you and whoever's on your pew this morning, and let us know what's going on with you. We have an amazing worship service planned for you today. We are glad that you are here, and we love you. Let us begin worship.
Please join me this morning as we sing one of the great hymns of faith, How Great Thou Art.
I hear the rolling thunder. All right. Good morning, church. As you can see, we are with our youth, and they are such an exciting bunch. I'm so grateful to be gathered with them on Zoom today, and they are going to pray for us and say our pastoral prayer. So I'd invite you all to go to the Lord in prayer with us during this time. Let us pray.
Lord, please help all our nation's leaders.
Lord, please help all of our
Lord, please help all of our sanitary system workers and those who are cleaning to keep us safe.
Dear Lord, please help our environment and our world stay safe.
Lord, please help our church workers and all the people that go to church stay safe and healthy.
Dear Lord, please help our grocery store workers and all those providing our food.
Dear Lord, please help all of our essential workers for power and internet.
Prayers for the delivery drivers, the truck drivers, and the entire supply chain.
Lord, hear our prayers, the prayers of your people and the prayers of your nation, reaching out to you and loving you during this difficult time. I'd invite all of you, all of our church family, and all of our youth at this time to say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We now move into the time of our service where we give God back our tithes and our offerings. We are reminded that during this time, just how blessed we are to connect with one another, to have this church not be the walls, but to be the people of this community. And we remember how blessed we really are. We invite you to continue supporting the mission of God here through Hilldale United Methodist Church by going to hilldaleumc.org/give. And you can give online just like you would if you were here each and every Sunday. Let us pray and thank God together for all the things we have been blessed with. Lord, we are so grateful for all that you have given us and all that you continue to do for us and how you are bringing us through this time together and continuing to allow us to be connected with one another. Lord, bless these gifts that we return to you now, both the giver and the recipient, as we seek to build your kingdom. In your son's name we pray. Amen.
Ready now?
Therefore, while the promise of entering his rest is still open, let us take care that none of you should seem to have failed to reach it. For indeed the good news came to us, just as to them. But the message they heard did not benefit them, because they were not united by faith with those who listened. For we who have believed enter that rest, just as God has said, "As in my anger I swore, they shall not enter my rest." Though his works were finished at the foundation of the world. For in one place it speaks about the seventh day as follows: "And God rested on the seventh day from all his works." And again in this place it says, "They shall not enter my rest." Since therefore it remains open for some to enter it, and those who formerly received the good news, failed to enter because of disobedience. Again, he sets a certain day, today, saying that through David, much later, in the words already quoted, today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. For if Joshua had given them rest, God would not speak later about another day. So then, a Sabbath rest still remains for the people of God. For those who enter God's rest also cease from their labors, as God did from his.
Hey kids, we are so glad you are with us in worship this morning. If you would, go ahead and grab your stuffed animal if you haven't already, and we are going to jump into a wonderful children's moment with Miss Kim. So come on down.
What's going on?
They're sleeping.
Wake up, guys. Wake up.
Oh.
Oh my goodness.
Oh man.
What's going on? Why is everybody sleeping? What's that flame? Huh? He said he just heard the Bible verse read by our friends Noah and Isaac, members of the Lamb family, and he said that's what he thought that meant, that they were supposed to take a rest right now. I don't think that's quite what the Bible verse meant, to rest right now.
Yeah. So what do you guys think of when you think of rest? So I know at my house, my kids, they don't really like to rest. They don't like to go to bed. They like to get up early. They don't want to nap. And so when we say to rest, they think about laying down and doing nothing. But in our Bible verse today, we're talking about how God rested after God's work. We're talking about how God has invited us into the Sabbath with Jesus. And so when we talk about rest, we're talking about kind of being in good relationship with God and with each other, in a place where we're not worried or angry or hurt, but in a place where we're in a good relationship with God, with each other, and we enter into this rest that is our kind of life with God. And so sometimes we find that in prayer or reading our Bibles or listening to wonderful music on the radio or in talking with our parents or our brothers and sisters. I bet you've experienced ways where you have felt that kind of like, oh, just a good old rest that might not have even been a nap, but just a good feeling that you are loved and cared for and that everything is okay. And that's what God has to offer us right now. In the midst of everything you hear on TV and your parents talking, God offers us a rest that lets us know that everything is okay and that you are loved.
Let's finish with one of those repeat after me prayers, Pastor Stephen.
Absolutely.
Dear Heavenly Father.
Dear Heavenly Father.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For rest.
For rest.
For peacefulness.
For peacefulness.
And for love.
And for love.
Amen.
Amen.
Boo! Do you know that feeling of fight or flight? You may even be feeling it right now in this moment. And I contend that we have been feeling like this fight or flight moment for a long time now. That with everything that's been going on around us, when we feel like the world is shaking, we respond by this idea of fight or flight. But we believe that God has something else planned for us. And so today we're going to be looking in Hebrews chapter 4. And I would encourage you to pull it out onto your mobile devices. We're going to talk through a few of the scriptures or pull your Bibles out right there at your homes. But we're going to be looking in Hebrews 4. And as we are, I know that some of us and many of us, if not all of us, know exactly what we're talking about in this feeling of fight or flight. Some of you are working, but it's the hardest work conditions you've ever had. You're working long hours and doing other people's jobs. You're in places where you don't know if you're going to be safe when you go home at night to be with your families. There are many of us who are raising kids now at home 24/7 in a way that we never planned on. Some of us are just in fear from getting the groceries or going to the store. And some of us are just frustrated that everybody else seems to be worried about something that they're not worried about. We know what this feeling of fight or flight is. And this is something that Christians have been dealing with for a long, long time. You see, when it comes to being able to find rest, I believe we have been struggling with two very big questions. When are we going to find that rest? And where are we going to find that rest? If you look in Hebrews 4, and I'm going to start with the very first part of verse 2, it says, "We also had the good news preached to us just as the Israelites did." Now here, the author of Hebrews is beginning to make an argument for the new Christians about how they can experience the Sabbath, how they can experience rest in Christ, in God, even though they are not the chosen people. You see, the people of that time began to think that the only way to experience true rest was to be in the promised land. And so he's telling them, we have also heard the good news preached just like the Israelites did. You see, it's common for us. We do the very same thing. Sometimes we think that we've got to get to a holy place to find some rest. That we've got to get to a destination, that we've got to get to some place where we aren't right now in order to find this rest, in order to experience God, in order to have right relationship with each other. But the author of Hebrews is trying to help new Christians understand that that is simply not the case. He goes on in verses 3 and 4. God's works were completed in the foundation of the world. Then somewhere he said this about the seventh day of creation. God rested on the seventh day from all his works. You see, we cannot get to the foundations of the world. And if God can rest in the foundations of the world, a place that we cannot attain, but yet God tells us that we can experience rest, then we can find that rest in places that we may have never thought of before. You see, we have a fear that we have to be in a holy place to find rest. But I don't believe that's true at all. You see, I believe that we have to be in a holy relationship to find rest. Now, I came out today to this creek because this is a place where I find rest. This is a place that soothes my soul. But even though I came to this place to try to get away, it's not the rocks and the water and even the trees and the wind and the critters, although they are beautiful and magnificent and they are the way that God created things to be. But that's not what brings me rest. What brings me rest is a holy relationship, a relationship that said, you know what? I want to create something beautiful for my beloved children. I have beloved children and I have created them and I want them to experience my wonder and my majesty and my love for them, even in the little details like rocks and running water and the beauty of the fish and the animals. I want them to find rest in places like that, but where I really want them to find rest is with me. You see, we don't have to be in a holy place, but we do need a holy relationship. When we look in Hebrews chapter 4, verses 7 through 8, we begin to see the second fear that the author of Hebrews begins to address with the people about how they can find rest. Verse 7 says, "Just as it says in the passage above, God designates a certain day as today. When he says through David much later, 'Today, if you hear his voice, don't have stubborn hearts.' If Joshua gave the Israelites rest, God wouldn't have spoken about another day later on." Now you see, the author of Hebrews is dancing on this word of today. He says that when God created the world, on the seventh day, he rested. And then the Israelites were told that one day they would reach the promised land and they would have rest. But then David in Psalm 95 says that we will have rest today. Today, if you hear my voice, his voice, don't have stubborn hearts. You see, this idea about today is that sometimes we believe that peace was only available then. That peace was available and sometimes in the past, but we've blown past it. It's over. It will never be that way again. Maybe you have even felt that way. You see, sometimes we begin to think that peace and rest will only be available in the future, when we can finally go back to church, when we can finally go back to restaurants, when we can finally go visit our family, there will be peace and rest and joy. But what about now? What about you today, right there? What about the month or 2 months or however long to come into the future? How are we going to find rest if it was only available in the past and it's only available in the future? You see, sometimes we think we have to return to the innocence of a child where we can just play in the streams and not have any cares in the world, and that was such a glorious time. Sometimes we believe in the ignorance of our own experience, that when we experience the world to be great, that everybody else must have experienced the same way, and we must go back to that time, and as long as we can get there, things will be good again. And sometimes we think we have to return, or rather get ready for, the incompetence of the future, as if one day it's just going to be perfect, as if one day it's just going to work out. And we look towards that one day in glory and we say, yes, that is true. But there's also now. You see, God did this amazing thing when God created us and put us in the midst of this thing called time. There is only the present. There is a memory of the past. There's a future we can't touch. But all we have is this moment that is called right now. And by the time we call it now, it's already past, and now it's the past. And by the time we get it out of our mouths to say now, it's already moved into the future and it's too late. We are a people who live in the now, but yet sometimes we think rest will only come when we look back at the Israelites or the foundation of the world, or a childhood, or the 50s, or the 60s, or the 70s, or the 80s, or whenever it is. Or sometimes we think that peace will only come when our bodies are finally made right. But what about now? You see, the truth is that rest was available then, and that rest will be available in the future, but that rest is available now. That godly rest and peace and joy and the fruit of the Spirit are here to be with us in this moment, in this place, right now. You see, the Gnostics believed that the soul had a home that came before and a home that it would go to one day. But in the interim, we were in a homeless journey in this world. But we as Christians, we don't believe that. God created our bodies to be temples, a place where the Holy One dwells. God created our minds to be inhabited by the thoughts and prayers of the people and the God who came before us. God created our souls to be inhabited by the Holy Spirit. God said, I am Emmanuel, I am with you, not last year, not next year, right here, right now. We celebrate it every year to remind us that God is Emmanuel. God is with us here and now, in our flesh, in our time, in our present. Rest is not only available at the end of a journey, rest is possible in the midst of the journey. This past week, I found rest in a place where I didn't think I would find rest. This past week, our dryer stopped working. I don't know if you've ever been at work and your wife texts or calls you and says, I need you to come home and fix the dryer. I got all these clothes and I don't know what I'm going to do and we need to fix it, right? And I decided I wasn't going to pay hundreds of dollars for somebody else to come in. So I took the dryer apart myself from top to bottom and tested everything and ordered a part and put it in and put it back together. And you know what? The dryer worked. I couldn't believe it. Neither could my wife or my kids. And I brought them in and I showed them. I was like, this is what we're doing. We're taking this apart. We're putting this back together. This is how we test the computer. This is what we do. And then we worked on the car. And we changed the rotors and the brake pads. And we changed the serpentine belt. And we did all this stuff. And we found ourselves hot and sweaty and greasy from fingertips to elbows. And we found ourselves in peace and rest and joy. And even in the midst of the journey and the hardness and the hardship and the work of what we had to do, there was a holy God who created us, who brought us together, who gave us a mind and skills and love for one another and love for creation, and gave us the opportunity to do something. And it was rest. Rest is available now, here, and in a holy relationship. And I want you to remember, as you go through your week and the news things that come on and the conversations with your children or your family, that even in this meantime, in between what was and what will be, there is a holy God that loves us, that is offering us rest. And will we find it? Our memory verse for today is going to come from chapter 4 in Hebrews. And I encourage you to find it, to put it on your mirror. And it's simply verse 16. And I'm going to share it with you now to close. Finally, let's draw near to the throne of favor with confidence so that we can receive mercy and find grace when we need help. You see, the past is already gone. It can't be helped. The future with God in heaven, we're not going to need any help. Where do we need help? Here and now. And that, my friends, is where we're going to find God. Amen. Let us pray together. Lord, thank you for the beauty of your creation. Thank you for the relationships we share with each other, and thank you that you have made those so strong that we want to be together as soon as we possibly can. But we know that rest doesn't come from a holy place, it comes from a holy relationship with you. We know that rest is not only available in the past and will be available in the future, but it is available now in our relationship with you. Lord, be with us, guide us, and give us some rest. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen.
Friends, I hope that you've been enjoying learning our chorus, Thrive. And today we're going to add another piece to that. We're going to do verse 1 and then the chorus that we already know. Here in this worn and weary land, where many a dream has died, like a tree planted by the water, we never will run dry. So living water flowing through, God, we thirst for more of you. Fill our hearts and flood our souls.
Beloved children of God, during a time when it can be a little stressful and a little anxious, we remember that we are children of the King, that we are a people that, even as we go through this week, are called to remember that in the love of God there is peace and there is joy, and it is waiting for you. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.